Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Today's lecture is regarding the histopathological findings of some common viral infections. The first viral infection which we are going to discuss is, of course, the most common one as well. Viral warts. You all know that viral warts present in different forms. So these are the common warts or the filiform warts. The most prominent histopathological finding, if we start from the top, it will be hyperkeratosis and acanthosis. That means the stratum corneum will be thickened. That's why warts are called as hyperkeratotic lesions. Those lesions in which the stratum corneum is thick. So, I think every one of you must have seen clinically the patients of warts. These warts are characterized by raised lesions which have thickened surface. But if you try to scratch this surface, it would not come out in form of scales. So, that's why the hyperkeratosis is different from papillomatosis from psoriasiform lesions, in which there is thick scaling. The scales, no matter how thick they are, if you scratch the scales, they will come out. But hyperkeratosis, like in warts, which is quite a thick hyperkeratosis, would not be scratched out even if you make a lot of effort. And even if you damage lots of superficial epidermis, it would not come out. So clinically, the thick hyperkeratotic lesion would histologically look like thick hyperkeratosis. The second feature of wart is thickened stratum spinosum. Stratum spinosum is already thickened, and this thickening of stratum corneum can be called as acanthosis, or it is a little bit more than acanthosis, so you may call it as psoriasiform hyperplasia. So you can see this stratum spinosum in form of irregular reti ridges, and the reti ridges, they are also fused with each other. But in addition to that, another feature which is seen typically in wart and other warty hyperkeratotic lesion is the papillomatosis. Papillomatosis is actually the part of epidermis which is protruding upwards in form of small church spires, or you can say tenting. So this thickened stratum spinosum is tented upwards or is projected upward. These are the small projections which are seen above the acanthotic or hyperplastic epidermis. So one presentation of epidermis is in a form of deep reti ridges, like we see in psoriasis and eczema. And in addition, this is another presentation of hyperplastic epidermis, that it is seen projecting upwards, superiorly, upwards. So this is called as papillomatosis. You can see this papillomatosis in other hyperkeratotic lesions. For example, in seborrheic keratosis. For example, in verrucous epidermal. For example, in sebaceous nevus. So, in case of hyperkeratotic actinic keratosis. So, in all these cases, you would see hyperkeratosis as well as the papillomatosis. Usually, along the projections of these papillae, superior to the projection, you will see thin, thick tiers of parakeratosis as well. But these parakeratotic columns, they are well insulated within the thick hyperkeratosis. So these parakeratosis will be just superior to the papillomatosis, and but they are not exposed to the surface. So the parakeratotic column would not be as bigger as compared to the other disorders which are associated with scaling. For example, not like actinic keratosis, but these thick tiers of parakeratosis will be seen superior to the papillomatous epidermis only. And in the concavities of the papillae, they will be less prominent. So, hyperkeratosis, papillomatosis. Then the third feature of the wart is hypergranulosis. The granular layer of the warty epidermis will be thick and prominent, will be characterized by prominent keratohyaline granules. The keratohyaline granules are the odolent bodies which are present in stratum granulosum normally. But in hyperkeratotic wart, these keratohyaline granules will be more prominent, making the stratum granulosum more obvious and more prominent, as you can see in this slide. This hypergranulosis is seen more in the concavities of the papillae. That is, between the two papillae, the granular layer will be more prominent, like this. So we have discussed till now three typical features of a common wart. Number one, thick hyperkeratosis. Number two, papillomatosis. And number three, hypergranulosis. Now, in addition to hypergranulosis, what else you would see in the granular layer is vacuolation of cytoplasm. That is, this is a normal granular layer cell. This is a normal stratum granulosum cell. There are a lot of granules within the cytoplasm of the cell. But here you can see that there is a vacuolation or a halo surrounding these stratum granulosum cells. Here is halo, here is an halo. The presence of this halo is, you can say, the first, the feature which is before the presence developing or before forming coelocytes. So stratum granulosum cells, the cells in the stratum granulosum, they will develop vacuolated cytoplasm and an halo. And pycnotic nuclei, that is, the nuclei would not be in a center now. It is shifted to one of the side of the cell. Like, this is the cytoplasm, this is the pycnotic nucleus, and there is a vacuolation and a halo. Still, they are not coelocytes, but these are the pre-coelocytes. So you can say that very soon you will see the vacuolation, the inclusion bodies here. Till the inclusion bodies are not there, you can still call them coelocytes, but because we call them coelocytes because the nucleus, because of the virus is already infiltrating these cells. So because of the infiltration of the virus, the nucleus is now degenerated and on the center. Most of the cytoplasm is vacuolated, and the cells will look like vacuolated or halo. There will be a surrounding halo in these cells. So these are the pre-coelocytes or the coelocytes without the presence of true viral inclusion. So in the middle of hypergranulosis, hyperkeratosis, and papillomatosis, if you see the vacuolated or halo type cells with abnormal or pycnotic nuclei, you will call them coelocytes and you will diagnose that as a viral wart. These are the plantar warts which we commonly come across in our OPDs. They are different now from the common wart in that there will not be so much hyperkeratosis which we have seen in the previous histological slide. Now, this is a typical picture of a plantar wart. Here, this plantar wart is in a form of a crater. The thick plaque, the hyperkeratotic plaque, rather than projecting upward, it is projecting downwards. Rather than seeing it as a protrusion here, where there are many common warts which are seen as protruded masses as well, most of the hyperkeratosis now is down beneath the skin surface. So this blood would only come out if you scrape the wart or you do a dressing, a salicylic acid dressing to soften this thick hyperkeratosis, and so that with the blade you can scrape it off. So here, the plantar wart is mainly in a form of a crater with keratotic plug filling that crater. The papillomatosis, the parakeratotic tiles are seen covering the papillomatous area. Now, this kind of stratum granulosum is now more towards the wart side. Now you can see that in addition, there are many coelocytes with a halo, with peripheral nuclei, irregular nuclei, and halogenated cells with pinkish keratohyaline granules. Now in this picture, you can see these typical viral inclusion bodies, these pink. Pink structures are the viral inclusion bodies. These are seen within the stratum granulosum cell nuclei. Here. These are all viral inclusion bodies. Well, here. So the viral inclusion bodies are seen within the nuclei as well as in the cytoplasm. They are described as intranuclear and intracytoplasmic viral inclusion. So now this is a picture of a typical coelocyte. Cell with an abnormal nucleus with a viral inclusion body and a halo located within the stratum granulosum. This is the electron microscopic appearance of human papilloma virus, showing a honeycomb appearance. This is the honeycomb appearance. Then these are the plain warts commonly seen on the face. The type of human papilloma virus in plain wart is different from the usual wart. Common wart or a plantar wart. Plain warts are not very hyperkeratotic. They have a plain top. So there will be hyperkeratosis, but not as much as we have seen in common wart nor in plantar wart. There will be hypergranulosis. But what you are seeing here more prominently That is intracytoplasmic vacuolation and halo, like cell in stratum granulosum. Rather than seeing these viral intrusion body, you can see these halo or vacuolated keratinocytes in stratum granulosum. So this picture, the vacuolated keratinocyte is typical of plain blood. This is condyloma acuminata caused by human papilloma virus 6/11/16. This appearance is almost same to the appearance of a common wart, but just because it is involving the moist genital surfaces, the appearance, the surface is rather soft or moist. This is condyloma acuminata. You can see the hyperkeratotic papillomatosis and acanthosis. The coelocytes will be seen. These are all vacuolated cells. These are the coelocytes. I cannot see any intrusion body here, but you can see the pycnotic nucleus. Most of the cytoplasm is vacuolated and look like vacuolated or halogenated cells. And then with abnormal or degenerated type of nucleus. EDV, epidermodysplasia verrucoformis. There are different kind of human papilloma virus that would cause EDV, characterized by innumerable soft flat warts. Can occur everywhere, including the face and chest. This is the histopathologic appearance. Plain warts, I have already shown you here. Since EDV has the appearance of a plain wart, histologically it would be also like the plain wart. There will be hyperkeratosis, hypergranulosis, acanthosis, and vacuolated keratinocytes in the superficial layer of, in upper layer of stratum spinosum or in stratum granulosum. These are the vacuolated or pale staining coelocytes. Sometimes this vacuolation will be more. The cells here are blue-gray and arranged in clusters and columns. So these are the now these vacuolated keratinocytes are occupying most of the stratum spinosum as well. Now we are done with the warts. So to summarize wart, what are the features which you would be looking for in case of a wart? Number one is hyperkeratosis. Number two is papillomatosis. Number three, acanthosis. So all those warts which have a filiform surface, the surface which is in a form of a projections, all those warts will have papillomatosis. So hyperkeratosis, thick hyperkeratosis will be seen in filiform wart, but just above the papillomatous surface, there will be parakeratotic tiles. In plantar wart, most of the thick hyperkeratotic plug is inside the surface, inside the skin surface. So rather than having a filiform appearance, these kind of warts, that is the plantar wart, have endophytic appearance. They are within, the keratin plug is within. So to remove that keratin plug, you have to scrape the wart. In addition, the most important feature of a viral wart is the prominent stratum granulosum, which is called as the hypergranulosis. So whenever you will be asked the condition having hypergranulosis, wart will be one of those. Another common condition which is characterized by hypergranulosis is lichen planus. But the feature which will be typical of wart is, in addition to the typical keratohyaline granules, there will be keratinocytes with vacuolated cytoplasm and pycnotic nuclei. That is, cytoplasm will be vacuolated or cytoplasm will be vacuolated and they appear as halo type cells with abnormal nuclei, and many of the times you will be able to see the eosinophilic inclusion bodies within the nuclei and in the cytoplasm. So these vacuolated pycnotic cells are the coelocytes. Even if they don't have the viral inclusion body. So this is all regarding the viral wart. Any question regarding the viral wart? Anything which you couldn't pick up from the histologia, if any doubt regarding the histopathological appearance of warts?
सर जो पिंकिश बॉडीज होती है वो सिर्फ प्लांटर में है या बाकी जितने भी टाइप ऑफ वॉर्ट्स है उसमें होती है
जी दोबारा बोले
सर जो पिंकिश इंट्रान्यूरल बॉडीज पर प्लांटर वॉर्ट्स कैन बी फाउंड इन अदर टाइप ऑफ वॉर्ट्स आल्सो
इट कैन बी सीन इन ऑल द वॉर्ट्स दिस वायरल इंक्लूजन बॉडीज विल बी सीन इन ऑल द वॉर्ट्स बिकॉज वायरस ने तो इन्फिल्ट्रेट किया ही हुआ है केराटिनोसाइट्स को अगर वायरस केराटिनोसाइट को इन्फिल्ट्रेट ना करे तो वॉर्ट बनेगा ही नहीं लेकिन जो हर एक वॉर्ट की बायोप्सी में वायरल इंक्लूजन बॉडीज मिलना आसान नहीं है ऐसे ही जैसे कि एंटीबॉडीज हर कुटेनियस लिशमेनिया की स्लाइड में हमें नजर नहीं आती लेकिन अगर हमें नजर नहीं आती एंटीबॉडी तो हम ये तो नहीं कह सकते कि लिशमेनिया ट्रोफोसाइट्स उस जगह पे इन है नहीं वो तो आपको हर चीज बायोप्सी में 100% फीचर्स नजर नहीं आते बट इवन इन एब्सेंस ऑफ वायरल इंक्लूजन बॉडीज यू विल बी एबल टू पिक अप द डिजीज्ड और डैमेज्ड केराटिनोसाइट्स बाय द टिपिकल अपीयरेंस ऑफ हैविंग पिकनोटिक न्यूक्लियाई and vacuolated cytoplasm. That is the message. There will be an overall picture of hyperkeratosis, papillomatosis, acanthosis, hypergranulosis, vacuolated keratinocytes in stratum granulosum with pycnotic nuclei. So till now, this is quite typical of diagnosing it as viral wart. Remember, viral wart will be coming in histopathological slides and reporting. So this is important. Now, the second important viral infection which we are going to discuss today is herpes. Clinically, herpes would look like group of small vesicles on an erythematous base. Herpes simplex type 2 will give a similar appearance, but because of the frictional tendency in this area, most of the vesicle will rupture soon, leaving erosion. So many a time, in case of herpes simplex type 2, you would not be seeing intact vesicle, you will be seeing eroded vesicle. But the typical small size and grouping will be able to make the diagnosis. So all members of herpes virus group have identical ultrastructural morphology. Note the outer membrane surrounding the viral core. The herpes virus is an isohedron with 162 capsomere on its surface. It's just an electron microscopic appearance, nothing more than that. You don't have to remember. Herpes simplex is characterized by intraepidermal vesiculation. Or rather, subcorneal vesiculation. But sometimes the whole epidermis is involved. Now just remember this thing, that whether it is a viral wart, or it's a herpes simplex wart, or any other wart, the first and foremost is the invasion of keratinocytes with that typical virus. Once the herpes simplex virus has entered the keratinocyte, it will cause the balloon degeneration of keratinocytes. The keratinocytes will be damaged from inside. Now, the damage in case of viral wart was in form of intracellular vacuolation and pycnosis. But here, the damage is little bit more. And individual cells, they are disintegrated or separated from each other because of this extreme degree of balloon degeneration and intracellular edema, leading to appearance which is similar to the appearance of pemphigus. But in pemphigus, you would be seeing acantholytic cell, which will also be seen here. But the individual keratinocytes will not be enlarged like the balloon degeneration of herpes simplex. The cells will be separated, but their size will not be more. But here you will be seeing many bloated keratinocytes in addition to that normal acantholytic cell. Here you can see this viral vesicle is completely involving the epidermis. There is only the dermis which is visible. No epidermis, rather epidermis is seen here, but there is no epidermis here. And virus is involving typically the whole epidermis. In addition to the balloon degeneration, to the acantholysis, to intracellular edema and disintegration, another typical feature which is seen in the herpes virus is the presence of these typical giant cells. These giant cells are not originating from the histocytes. These are the epidermal keratinocytes, which rather than individually separating from each other, they have separated in a form of clusters. This kind of epidermal giant cells will not be seen in pemphigus vulgaris or foliation. So once you do the Zank smear, you should all be well aware how the Zank smear is performed, because this is a Stokes station as well. And not only how the Zank smear is performed, but what is the purpose of Zank smear. Many a times, there will be a confusion between pemphigus and herpes. In that case, you would be looking for these giant cells, because acantholytic cells will be seen both in herpes and in pemphigus. But giant cells will not be seen in pemphigus. And neither these kind of ballooned keratinocytes. These balloon keratinocytes will also be not seen in pemphigus. So now you can see here, intraepidermal vesicle with some residual keratinocytes below, intracellular edema, balloon degeneration, bloated keratinocytes, and acantholysis. Here, now, you see the typical viral inclusion. Actually, the viral inclusion are the virus particles. So you will see here, these black color structures, these are all viral inclusions. These are keratinocyte nuclei, and these viral inclusions are involving these keratinocyte nuclei. These are the viral inclusions of herpes are intranuclear inclusions. The viral inclusions of viral warts were intranuclear as well as intracytoplasmic. But the viral inclusions of herpes are intranuclear inclusions. There can be different shapes, but these inclusions are present mainly on the keratinocyte. Of course, these viral inclusions here, they are again the inclusion, this black one. These kind of inclusions are again not seen in pemphigus. So giant cells, balloon cells, acantholytic cells, and the cells containing viral inclusions. These are balloon cells. Cells are of different shapes and sizes here. This is a typical appearance of herpes symptoms. If in doubt, which usually we are not, we can perform immunohistochemistry with herpes simplex virus antibody. And wherever the herpes simplex virus is present within these keratinocytes, in these antibodies will be deposited on those sites. These antibodies are against the human papilloma virus, and since these antibodies are tagged with particular enzymes which will change color to brown, so this will be all these keratinocytes with these viral human papilloma viruses will be stained as brown, as we do in other immunohistochemistry stains. Chickenpox is caused by varicella zoster virus. You know all how chickenpox would look like. There are crops of polymorphic lesion with vesicles and with pustules and surrounding erythema. Herpes zoster, again, there will be grouped vesicles in a dermatomal distribution. But unlike chickenpox, which are polymorphic, which occur in form of crops, herpes zoster will not be in the form of crops. All the lesions will have the same age and same morphology. The histopathological appearance of varicella, as well as of varicella zoster virus, as well as of herpes simplex, will be similar. There will be intra-epidermal vesiculation with balloon degeneration, intracellular edema, acantholysis, and giant cells. And to highlight further, we have immunohistochemistry for varicella zoster virus. So histopathologically, both type of herpes viruses, 1, 2, and 3, which is the varicella zoster virus, will have the similar histopathological appearance. Cytomegalovirus is also a type of herpes virus. It is an opportunistic infection with a benign course in a healthy host, but more ominous course in an immunocompromised population. Cytomegalovirus most commonly affect the visceras, particularly respiratory and GI tract. However, the cutaneous lesions are also seen, which are though not as prominent as we see in case of herpes virus, but mainly present as non-pruritic macular lesion with scattered vesicles or bullae. So the lesions are not very specific. Histologically, it is characterized by marked and enlarged eosinophilic endothelial cells lining the small blood vessels. All the brunt of the disease or the virus is on the endothelial cells lining the blood vessel. And it is characterized by large intranuclear inclusions, which are densely eosinophilic. So this is a blood vessel. These are the normal endothelial cells. These are the endothelial cells that are characterized by intranuclear inclusions, and which are the cytomegalovirus. So cytomegalovirus is infiltrating the endothelial cells and not the keratinocytes like we have seen in warts and in herpes. In addition to the endothelial cells, they will also be infiltrating fibroblasts and other epithelial cells, maybe some keratinocytes as well. So all these cells which will be damaged by cytomegalovirus will be characterized by intranuclear intrusion. Hand, foot and mouth disease characterized by vesicular, papillovesicular lesions and erosions on oral mucosa, hands and feet caused by Coxsackie A16. Histologically, it will be characterized by intra and intracellular edema leading to intraepidermal vesiculation. Degenerative changes have resulted in epidermal separation. So this is characterized. Hand, foot and mouth disease is similar in appearance to herpes simplex as far as the damage to epidermis is concerned, characterized by intercellular and intracellular edema and degenerated keratinocytes. But the giant cells, which we see in herpes simplex, will not be seen in other vesicular viruses like in hand, foot and mouth, mainly degenerated keratinocytes and the inter and intracellular edema and chronic infiltration. Now, ORF. ORF is typical verrucous, erythematous, eroded, raised nodule, which we see in people handling the kettle and mainly on the hands. Comes in a differential diagnosis of pyogenic granuloma. Typically characterized histologically by dense intraepidermal edema, intraepidermal vesiculation, and epidermal necrosis. These are all features of ORF, Milker nodules, or similar kind of infection in which you would be expecting this kind of lesion, you would be expecting a lot of epidermal damage and intraepidermal vesiculation. In the middle, you can see a few intracytoplasmic inclusions. So these viral bodies will be seen in as a form of intracytoplasmic inclusion. This is a ORF virus you can see on electron microscope. Then Molluscum contagiosum virus, another typical virus which we come across very frequently, especially in children, characterized by papules which have an umbilicated top. Just like in umbilicus, there will be a little little depression on the top of these of papules. This is a typical Molluscum contagiosum virus, which is indistinguishable from other pox virus. Most of the lesion Molluscum contagiosum is endophytic. That is, there will be a small punctum, which is apparent on clinically as well. So this is the surface and Molluscum is beneath the surface. Epidermis will be hyperkeratotic and you will be seeing the typical intracellular molluscoid bodies. The molluscoid bodies are again viral inclusions. Here the viral inclusions are intracytoplasmic, not intranuclear like in herpes. And these viral inclusions have, they are so big that they have occupied the whole of the cytoplasm and pushing the nucleus to one side, pushing the nucleus of keratinocytes to one side. This is a thin layer of nucleus which is pushed to one side. Similar kind of nuclei you see in because of huge intracytoplasmic vacuolation, the nuclei shifted to one side. Similar kind of nuclei you will see in lipomas, in which the typical fat globules, they have pushed the nucleus of sebaceous or nuclei of subcutaneous fat to one side. So here it is stratum, here it is stratum spinosum, and the viral inclusions are intracytoplasmic viral inclusions, and these viral inclusions have pushed the keratinocyte nuclei to one side. So you cannot miss this appearance of molluscum contagiosum. There will be a little depression, that is the crater, which appears clinically in a form of a punctum. Then there will be epidermal hyperplasia, and most of the epidermis, the keratinocytes, they will be infiltrated by intracytoplasmic viral inclusions, which have pushed the keratinocyte nuclei to one corner, one side, in a form of a thin longitudinal mass. So that is all regarding the molluscum contagiosum. So after what we have discussed herpes, we discussed cytomegalo, we discussed ORF, and now molluscum contagiosum. Any doubt or any question regarding these?
ORF is inclusion body sir, go kaise hoti hai?
Cytoplasmic, intracytoplasmic inclusions. ORF की जो main characteristic है वो extreme degree of epidermal necrosis and intra-epidermal vesiculation या necrosis. ORF की कोई typical histology नहीं, इस तरह की appearance हर उस condition में होगी जिसमें epidermal necrosis हो. तो इसलिए ORF की कोई typical histology नहीं है. Typical histology थी WARTS की, typical histology थी herpes की, टिपिकल हिस्टोलॉजी थी मोलस्कम कंटेजियोसम. साइटोमेगालो वायरस की अव्वल तो हम बायोप्सी नहीं करते, और लेकिन अगर हम बायोप्सी करें तो यार थोड़ी डिफिकल्ट बायोप्सी है कि जिसमें आपको ब्लड वेसल्स के अंदर देखना है वायरस को. स्वॉलन एंडोथेलियल सेल्स विद इंट्रा न्यूक्लियर इंफ्यूजन. लेकिन अदरवाइज जो आप लोगों के लिए एग्जाम में इम्पॉर्टेंट हिस्टोलॉजिकल अपीयरेंसेज हैं वो इन तीन बीमारियों, वॉट्स, हर्पीस एंड मोलस्क.
एक्सक्यूज मी सर, सर इंट्रासाइटोप्लाज्मिक इंक्लूजन बॉडीज तो होती हैं, किसी डिजीज में इंट्रा न्यूक्लियर इंक्लूजन भी होती हैं?
मैंने बताया ना आपको, वायरल वॉट्स के अंदर भी इंट्रा न्यूक्लियर भी होती हैं और इंट्रासाइटोप्लाज्मिक भी होती है. और इंट्रा न्यूक्लियर तो मैंने आपको एक इमेज में दिखाई भी थी वॉट में. फिर आ जाए हर्पीस पे, हर्पीस में इंट्रा न्यूक्लियर इंक्लूजन है, इंट्रा साइटोप्लाज्मिक नहीं है. वॉट में दोनों है, लेकिन हर्पीस में इंट्रा न्यूक्लियर इंक्लूजन. इस तरह साइटोमेगालो वायरस में भी इंट्रा न्यूक्लियर इंक्लूजन. फिर आ गया जनाब ORF, ORF में इंट्रा साइटोप्लाज्मिक इंक्लूजन. और आखिर में आ गया मोलस्कम कंटेजियोसम, जिसमें इंट्रा साइटोप्लाज्मिक इंक्लूजन हैं और बहुत प्रोमिनेंट इंट्रा साइटोप्लाज्मिक इंक्लूजन हैं कि जिन्होंने वॉट केरेटिनोसाइट्स के न्यूक्लियाई को एक साइट के ऊपर पुश कर. तो कुछ वायरल इंफेक्शन में इंट्रा न्यूक्लियर हैं और कुछ में इंट्रा साइटोप्लाज्मिक.
जी सर, ओके, थैंक यू वेरी मच.
इसमें ना जो तीन टिपिकल या इम्पोर्टेंट हिस्टोलॉजीज हैं, इसमें ये याद रखें कि वॉट में दोनों हैं, मोलस्कम में इंट्रासाइटोप्लाज्मिक है और हर्पीज में इंट्रा न्यूक्लियर. वॉट में दोनों, मोलस्कम में इंट्रासाइटोप्लाज्मिक और हर्पीज में इंट्रा न्यूक्लियर.
जी सर, थैंक यू वेरी मच सर.
एक्सक्यूज मी सर, एक थोड़ा मैम आपने ये सब करना बैलून डीजनरेशन.
मुझे आपकी आवाज नहीं आ रही, आवाज नहीं आ रही.
अच्छा सर, एक बैलून डीजनरेशन का ना आपने, एक रेटिकुलर डीजनरेशन होते हैं ना सर, तो एक कंटिन्यूम ऑफ द स्पेक्ट्रम में अलग अलग चीजें सर.
दोबारा मुझे समझ नहीं आया क्या सवाल था.
बलून डीजनरेशन वर्सेस रेटिकुलर डीजनरेशन सर.
देखो, बलून डीजनरेशन का मतलब होता है इंट्रा सेलुलर एडिमा, बिकॉज ऑफ द इन्फिल्ट्रेशन ऑफ सेल्स बाय वायरल पार्टिकल्स, द सेल वॉल हैज बिकम पोरस, एज अ रिजल्ट ऑफ व्हिच एडिमा फ्लूइड हैज एक्युमुलेटेड विद इन द सेल्स, leading to further damage to the cell. This is called as balloon degeneration. Reticular degeneration, in cellular degeneration mein istemal nahi ki jati. Ye aur term use hogi dermis ke andar, mujhe is waqt uski exact याद नहीं है, लेकिन हमें अभी इसको ना किसी तौर पे भी रेटिकुलर डिजेनरेशन से कंफ्यूज करने की जरूरत नहीं, क्योंकि हम जो जिस टॉपिक को अभी स्टडी कर रहे हैं वो है बैलून डिजेनरेशन। बैलून डिजेनरेशन का मतलब ये है कि वायरस ने इन्फिल्ट्रेट किया केराटिनोसाइट से, और केराटिनोसाइट्स को इन्फिल्ट्रेट करके उसने उसकी उसकी सेल मेम्ब्रेन है उसको पोरस कर, जिसकी वजह से फ्लूइड सेल्स के अंदर एक्यूमुलेट हो, और जैसे जैसे फ्लूइड एक्यूमुलेट होगा सेल डैमेज होना शुरू होगा।
जो जायंट सेल है वो होल ऑफ द केराटिनोसाइट मिलके पांच छह इकट्ठे बना के मिलके बनती है, जिस उनके न्यूक्लियस होते हैं।
तो केराटिनोसाइट्स तो डैमेज हो रहे हैं ना, और केराटिनोसाइट्स टूट भी रहे हैं, तो उन केराटिनोसाइट्स कुछ केराटिनोसाइट्स ऐसे हैं कि जो आपस का कनेक्शन को लूज किए बगैर वो बाकी एपिडर्मस से सेपरेट हो गए। तो वो केराटिनोसाइट्स जिन्होंने एक दूसरे के साथ जुड़े हुए केराटिनोसाइट्स से वो जॉइंट सेल्स बनाते, जिनको हम एपिडर्मल जॉइंट सेल्स कहते हैं या केराटिनोसाइट जॉइंट सेल्स कहते हैं। एक्चुअली दे आर कोलेस्ड केराटिनोसाइट्स, दे आर नॉट हिस्टोसाइट। ठीक है, चलो दैट्स ऑल फॉर टुडे। सो ईद मुबारक एंड हैव अ नाइस हॉलीडेज। खुदा हाफिज़।